Today, there are many of the intelligentsia who have their skill and the forthright will to scribe their thoughts on paper for the readership of many. With their CV listing employment, education, places and times this was done to give credence to the position and skills they possess. Gordon carried a name, this was his credential. His first direct ancestor recorded in legal documents was Robert Gordon, who went to France to seek his fortune early in the 18th century. He set up a wine and spirits business and prospered exceedingly. With his shrewdly acquired wealth, he bought two estates in Scotland to establish the family as landed gentry. Adam was a traditional Gordon name, which can be traced back to the false Gordon, the villain of the Scots ballad, Adam O'Gordon. His family referred to him as Lindsay. His father, Adam Durnford Gordon, born to affluence and security, followed a family tradition by going into the army. His father was once described by Lindsay in the Australasian in 1868 as the paragon who, furnished with a common boar spear, sharp sabre, and mounted on his favourite Arab horse, used to kill tigers single-handed in open country. Presumably, this activity made up for being posted to India and missing out on the battles against the French led by Bonaparte, which ended at Waterloo. Durnford Gordon was a quick-witted fellow, as well as an exceptionally skilled linguist, talented in poetry and sketching. In common with his wife Harriet, they were both very tall. Harriet was graceful and handsome, best described by her niece Frances, very artistic in her taste, but peculiar. When crinolines were in fashion, she would have none. And wearing a long, limp dress, she used to look very remarkable. A vibrant temper betrayed Harriet, charming and gentle when in a good mood, and absolutely unreasonable when she was not, perfectly capable of throwing a knife or poker at anyone. She never settled, and she spent her life travelling throughout the cities of Europe. If it is true that children inherit ability and talent through the genes, then Lindsay was labelled with Calvin Klein's, stylish and classy, but still a hard-wearing fabric. There is no footage of these times past, but the records of words that have been passed on, that once the pomp and frumpery appealed away, these people were just like you and I. In their time, the planet was still being explored as civilizations reached out around the globe in the unending cycle of humanity's growth. Lindsay was the first Australian poet to be read by the ordinary man. H.M. Green, in reviewing, perhaps speaks for the reader of his poems when he wrote, "We read Gordon not for his fine phrases, but for the directness of some cry, and above all for the breadth and effectiveness of any utterance taken as a whole. And we read him because even if we ourselves are not hunters, sportsmen, soldiers, adventurers, he uncovers some underlying stratum of such men in us, opening up to us the road of adventure and blowing over it the wind of romance." His sometimes naive, sometimes ironic comments on life may be largely the result of early experience. Gordon's poems are predominantly poetry of action and human passion. They contain the first stirrings of a national school of Australian poetry recognised by his writing poems in the first instance and in the creation of the Australian ballad, followed by Banjo Paterson, Lawson and others. Ah, friend, did you think when the London sank, timber by timber, plank by plank, in a cauldron of boiling surf, how alone at least, with never a flinch, in a rally contested inch by inch, you could fall on the trampled turf. When a livid wall of the sea leaps high in the lurid light of a leaden sky and bursts on the quarter railing, while the howling storm gust seems to vie with the crash of splintered beams that fly, yet fails too oft to smother the cry of women and children wailing. Then those who listen in sinking ships to the despairing sobs of their loved ones' lips, where the green wave thus slowly shatters, may long for the crescent claw that rips the bison into ribbons and strips and tears strong elk to tatters. Oh, sundering short of body and breath, oh, battle and murder and sudden death, against which the liturgy preaches, by will of a just yet merciful power, less bitter perchance in the mystic hour, when the wings of the shadowy angel lower, the man in his blindness teaches.